Eastern Promises is basically about the Russian mob in London, which was a subject that was fairly obscure when we started shooting, but by the time we were halfway through it, it was, as I like to say, radioactively hot, since there was a poisoning of a Russian former KGB agent that happened very close to where we were shooting the movie.
One is very, very aware in recent years of a migration from Russia of all sorts of wonderful people and less wonderful people, extremely dangerous people.
She was 14 when he raped her. You bastards murdered her.
Vory V Zakone are thieves, you know. Thieves have a code of behavior, you know. There are certain unwritten rules of behavior that if you violate them, you're out, and maybe you're dead.
Live only by stealing, by theft. In Russian, it's Vory. And code in Russian is Zakon. Therefore, we are thieves by the code.
To be a thief in law, you need to have had professional criminal experience, a significant amount. You need to have a few prison terms at least.
Питерских крестах сидел, дюжина ходов сидел.
And you don't steal from other thieves, if you don't lie to other thieves, and you don't misrepresent who you are, and if you can take a beating, you're probably going to be all right.
You never know who they are. The secret about this Russian mafia, they're not visible. And you never can really point, oh yeah, he did this murder thing. They disappear.
My friend says his uncle owns the restaurant where you can sing. He is sure this man will take care of me.
The BBC wanted something about Eastern European prostitutes in London, but I wanted to take a conventional English person and lead her into that world.
I think everyone is very aware of this traffic that goes on of young girls from Russia, well, from all over, actually. It's a disgusting traffic.
It's everywhere, actually. It's in London, it's in Paris, it's in Moscow. Prostitution is the oldest job in the world.
I know now for sure that I am pregnant. I am condemned to give birth to a new life. The windows won't open, so I can't throw myself out.
It's an invisible trade. The girls who are trafficked are very rarely seen. They're kept behind closed doors. They're kept as slaves, effectively. So there is this sort of slavery within modern London, which is quite shocking.
Tell him what I said.
There is nothing to tell. Slaves give birth to slaves.
For trafficking heroin, someone will get 40 years. For trafficking 100 human beings, they'll get 6 months to a year. It's not considered to be the big crime because, first of all, they can always allege that it was all done voluntarily. And also, the girls will very rarely give evidence. So it's much more lucrative and less dangerous to traffic people than it is to traffic heroin.
How can you keep doing what you're doing?
I'm just a driver. I told you this. You cannot do deals with those people.
Anna enters into this world of absolute intrigue, and she doesn't know the depth of danger to begin with. I mean, they appear to be so friendly, these people.
She gradually meets all of us and is appropriately freaked out by you know, the vibe we give off, I suppose.
Where have you taken Christine? Tell me, you bastard! You've taken her! Tell me!
That's good.
You can't slot in 20 actresses into this kind of role. There are emotional subtleties, there are linguistic subtleties, sociological subtleties involved with this character, and she has to be convincing also as a midwife. And that's a key point in the narrative.
Fetal heart rate's at 60, 58.
Naomi was just first on our list. I mean, everybody felt this woman is the perfect actress for this role. We felt that she and Viggo would have huge chemistry together, which is interesting because it's not really a love story in the traditional sense. I mean, they don't get together in the movie. And I think that's unusual, and it's one of the things that was interesting about the script is that they're like ships that pass in the night, you know? They're connected, but they're not connected.
До свидания, Анна Ивановна.
До свидания.
With someone like David, you don't really panic too much because he's an auteur, he knows what he's doing, and I would never have signed on if I didn't believe, and he just sort of instilled me with confidence.
He's flexible, but at the same time very sure of himself. Maybe that's why he's flexible, but that's a nice person to work with.
I seem to be drawn to kind of enclosed, hermetically sealed subcultures, whether they're ones that I've invented myself in sci-fi terms, or things like M. Butterfly, which was the Peking opera. And this is not only Russian culture, transplanted to England, but mob culture, which is a subculture of a subculture. I think it's my existentialist underpinnings that draw me to that, the idea that we create our own reality through our culture and our art. We create a reality that seems as real as anything else, but in fact is quite transitory and is really a projection of our own creative will. And so too it is with this crime family that we discover in Eastern Promises.
Right.
One of the characters who owns the restaurant is based on a real person who I've met, who was charming, elegant, well-read, and also a trafficker, who I'm not going to name because it would be dangerous. It's a moment that I try to put into the film where you're in a situation where you think, oh, you know, this is an interesting person. He reads Pushkin and he's quite literate. And then his friends arrive and you start thinking, oh, right, that's who he is. You're beguiled by a situation and then you start to realize that actually this is all part of a larger picture. In the world of trafficking and gangsterism and all of that.
In this business, sometimes the biggest danger comes from the most stupid things.
There's a certain tradition to play a kind of mafia boss, like Marlon Brando did it, like Al Pacino did it. And I'm trying to find a way to make my own way. Not easy if there's a tradition to play certain parts. I hope it will work. I'm not quite sure. You never know.
You belong in there, with nice people. Stay away from people like me.
Getting ready is one of the parts of making movies that I like the most. That's where you really learn a lot.
Viggo's method is not the method. You know, he's not a method actor in the strict sense, but he does do a lot of research.
I feel like I'd at least done my best in terms of getting ready to play the part. I knew that I had to go to Russia, where Nikolai's meant to be from, which is a couple time zones east of, you know, Moscow, St. Petersburg, and the Urals area, and Yekaterinburg, which is far, far away from Western Europe, and it feels quite different.
Doing that, really without specific contacts, he would just meet people, somehow they'd communicate, and he would absorb them, you know, absorb their Russianness.
He really spent a lot of time with a lot of very disreputable Russian people and came back with this character. I write the lines, but the character, the heart and soul of it is really from him.
I met some people who actually are people like Nikolai or like his associates. They didn't tell me that much, but they just sort of gave me an idea of what certain things meant and what things would be authentic. And if we're doing a certain kind of scene, even if it might not happen exactly like that, the idea, the spirit of it was right.
I get this line. I work with a lot of Russians, and Viggo has nailed it perfectly, just the way he walks, the way he talks. Is the way he moves his head, it's totally Russian.
Азимат племяш перерезал соки глотку. Кирилл заказал его. Закрой брат свой рот.
There's a couple scenes that are just in Russian. One short one that's in Russian and Ukrainian, and then another one in which I'm interviewed by some Russian or Slavic, you know, underworld types. It just makes you feel, I think, as an audience, hopefully, that you're eavesdropping. You're glimpsing another world, you know, there's another feeling. And it helps you as an actor, too, to believe what you're doing.
Every movie has knots that have to be untied, and this was one of the ones for us, was the language question. So what do you do, you know? Do you cast English-speaking actors who will then do a Russian accent, as in fact we were doing with Viggo? And I felt that it would be a lot more interesting to look for European actors who could do a Russian accent, who could speak English. Armin is German, Vincent is French. Jerzy Skolimowski, who is better known perhaps as a director, he speaks Russian, but with a Polish accent. So we had to draw all these disparate versions of Russianness together that would be believable, really, to a Russian audience, and it seems to work.
Давай с нами в бизнес.
This movie will be reminiscent, you know, it'll seem like, in some ways, a logical follow-up to History of Violence. The question of, is violence ever justified? Is lying ever justified?
I am driver, that's it.
Is cruelty unavoidable in some cases? Can violence be a force of good? I mean, as usual, David doesn't really answer that. He asks a lot of questions and you're stuck thinking for yourself.
My desire always is to make a really complex, textured film that you can see many times and that will stay with you and will not just be a consumer item that's gone 2 hours after you've seen it. That's the only way I can evaluate it. And I think I've achieved that with Eastern Promises, but that's as far as I can go.